Very good.
Hello, 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 hello.
This is Thursday, March 5th, 1992. We're in the dining room at Mrs. Sloan Shepherd's home on 5th Street in Roscommon, and we're going to do a little interview for Mrs. Shepherd.
Well, I was born in Crawford County, Maple Forest Township. And my very first day of school, I think I was 7 years old.
Oh, tell us what day you were born.
I was born June the 11th, 1892, in Maple Forest.
Okay. Were you the oldest in your family?
I was the youngest of family of five.
Okay. What did your father do for a living?
My parents were farmers. They cleared up 80-some acres and farmed it.
Did you have animals?
And we had most all the animals that one of us had farm. And I remember that the winters were quite long. We had lots of snow. Very much snow. And I remember when we hear the rooster call in the spring, well, the chicken must have laid an egg somewhere, so we rush out and look for the first egg.
Oh, sure, that was exciting. So you started school when you were seven?
Yes.
Where did you have to go to school then?
I went to Maple Forest, just a one-room school.
Was that near your house then?
No, it was a mile. I had to walk a mile
mm-hmm.
to school. And sometimes the weather was pretty bad. But in those days, they just had terms
mm-hmm.
of school.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe a term would be three months.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'd have vacation.
Did your brothers and sisters all go to the same school with you? Did you all go together?
No.
When you left for school in the morning, were you all?
I went with my sister, who was 2 years older than me.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
The older ones went to school in town, I think. I said, you what? You thought about that.
And how long did you go to school at this school that was nearby?
I think I went to the 8th grade.
To the 8th grade?
Yes.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Very good. Okay, well, let's talk about when you came to Roscommon then. Well, we just got you to the 8th grade. We should keep going there, I guess. What did you do after 8th grade then?
Well, I think I went to school in Grayling for a while. I went to school in Frederick. And then I had an opportunity in Grayling to go to school there. So I was there several months. And I came back home. And that was in the 9th grade. I didn't go any farther than that because we were of limited means.
That was pretty good in those days, though. You were happy that you went that long.
Yes.
Yeah, sure. That's neat. Okay, tell us why you came to Roscommon, or when you came.
Well, I worked in Frederick for a while. There was a small bank there. And I worked there, and I really got quite an insight of banking there in a small way. And I liked Davis. I got along real well. But there was an opening in Roscommon at a lumber business. So I made application. My brother brought me down here to look it over. And I was hired.
Mm-hmm. That was the Blanchard Lumber Company.
And that was Charles Blanchard
mm-hmm.
Lumber. And he had many interests. He had one in DeBoard. He had to go there occasionally. And I really got into the lumber business. I liked it too. I got so I could tell different kinds of moldings and different grades of lumber and how to figure lineal. And
mm-hmm. Sure, I bet that was interesting. I bet
yeah.
It was a busy place.
And it was nice.
Yeah.
And then I worked there a couple of years. And then it happened that my future husband was way off in Russia, the very northern part. And the armistice was signed in November of 1918. And he didn't know anything about it until spring.
Oh my gosh.
He didn't know a thing about it.
Wow.
And he came back and was around for a while. And he worked for Charles Blanchard too. Well, I guess maybe we fell in love there.
I guess you did. I guess you did.
And so, 2 years hence, it was 1920. We were married in January of 1920.
So where were you married?
We were married in Bay City.
Oh.
A quiet wedding.
Oh, that was nice. How did you get there?
On the train.
On the train.
And so when he came back, we had a hard time kind of finding a place to live, but we located a place. And we had bought our furniture, and we bought that. And so we lived there from January until about October. In the meantime, my husband bought a place in Roscommon. A place that really needed repairs. Well, we fixed it up and moved in October
and
of 1920.
Which place is that? Is that this house? Oh, perhaps. So this house was already in need of repair when you bought it. It wasn't a new house.
No.
How old was it when you bought it, did you think?
Well, I don't know how old it was.
Hmm. So it's one of the early, early houses?
Yes. Well, the first house that was built.
Where did you live from January to October? Did you just
we
rent
a little house up on the hill?
Oh, that you just rented?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. When you first came here in 1918, you said you stayed at the Gallimore House.
Yes.
What can you tell us about that? What do you remember?
Oh yes, I remember quite a bit about that. Mrs. Gallimore was a very good cook, and she kept us well fed. And her husband drove a liver.
Mm-hmm.
And he would, people come in, tourist people would come in on the plane. He'd meet them at the depot. And he'd take them to the lake. That was his
business.
Livelihood.
How often did the train come through here?
Every day.
With people?
Every
Once
day.
Once a day?
Yes.
Oh, wow. So at the Gallimore House, how many other boarders were there when you were there?
Oh, there was Pearl Love. She was my roommate.
Oh. Did you have an upstairs room?
Yes.
And how many rooms were there up there? Were there three?
I think there were two or three.
And Mrs. Gilmore lived downstairs?
Yes.
Very good.
She's a very nice lady, and he was very nice too, and they made us feel at home.
Mm-hmm. Had a little family there, huh? That was nice. Okay, getting back to your husband being in Northern Russia in 1918 at the end of World War One.
Yeah, he was in the engineer corps.
Okay, tell us what you might remember from his recollection of World War One.
I remember that at that time there was an epidemic of influenza. And my sister was a nurse in Ann Arbor. And I had to leave my place of business where I was employed to go to Ann Arbor and take care of my sister. And I remember that the students died at a terrible rate.
Mm. Now, what year was that?
1918.
Oh, in 1918.
Yeah,
so that
I
was before.
I hadn't been here very long.
Oh.
And we were pretty excited that the armistice had been signed. And I was there about 6 weeks, and it seemed like everybody around there had the flu. People wore masks in those days to see if it would prevent them from getting the disease. So I wore one. And all that time, I didn't get it.
Wonderful.
And I came home.
And your sister got better?
Yes, my sister got better. So she continued her nursing career.
Mm-hmm. So now your husband's first name was Clarence. How long was he... Did he serve in World War One?
About 2 months.
Oh, almost 2 years. What kind of stories did he tell when he came back?
Well, the snow was pretty deep. And, of course, he was in Russia. And he told about how they lived there. They had bunks up around the great big furnace where they would sleep to keep warm.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And what was his job in the service? You said he was in engineering?
He was a
cool.
Well, he fixed bridges, things like that.
Oh.
They fixed bridges, did things, repaired. Kept them repaired. And they brought back a whole bunch of pictures of Russia. And I kept them for a long time after he died. And finally I gave them to my nephew to keep.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a nice remembrance. Nice that he had kept them all that time. Okay, so how long did your husband continue to work at Blanchard's? And so after you were married, did you both continue to work there?
Just for a short time.
Oh, mm-hmm. Then what did he do?
Because I stayed home, and our first child was born in February of the next year.
Oh, well, that was nice. You got into motherhood right away. And then how long did he stay at Blanchard's Lumber Company?
For quite a while.
Did he?
Until the business was sold to Claude the Rock.
Oh, and then your husband didn't work there anymore?
No. He went into the automobile business with John Dye.
Oh. Okay.
They sold Ford cars.
Oh, what year was that? Did they start doing that?
In the early 20s.
Oh, so that was fairly soon after mm-hmm. you were married. Mm-hmm. Where was his business located?
It was on Lake Street, And it's that building, it belongs to the school district now. It was across, it was in the block across from Gavin's grocery.
Oh.
That building.
The one that's the warehouse now at the corner?
That was where that first business.
Oh, so that was from a Ford garage, it was a Ford, they had a Ford garage. They sold cars and repaired them. And how long did your husband do that?
Well, I don't remember.
A long time though, until he retired?
Several years.
Mm-hmm. Oh, just.
No, they didn't stay. They built a new building. They built new building down here on the corner of Lake and Fifth.
Where Impact Office is now?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, they built that.
Yeah. That was building 33.
Oh.
And that's where they did business.
Oh, wow. And so they, how long were they in that building then?
Until he died.
Oh, until he died.
Yeah. He had to, he was a Ford dealer for many years.
Yeah, I guess he was. Because he lived to be how old?
60.
60. Mm-hmm. Okay. Tell me what you have talked to me at other times about what it was like when the deer hunters came.
Well, the town would be just crowded.
This was a hot spot, huh?
We looked forward to it.
Sure.
And I used to keep hunters. I used to turn over that every bedroom and house to hunters. And I had some that came year after year. They were real nice people.
Mm-hmm. So it started out that they weren't friends though, but you just got to know them because they came back
all
the
time. Yeah, they came to the door, mm-hmm. wanted the room, and they looked pretty good, so I said, okay.
That's amazing. Had they come in here, had they come to Roscommon by train or by car or what?
No, they drive.
They'd come by car at that time.
And one man got the deer and he was going to lead it on his car out in front. It was fastened on his car. He thought that he'd lead it there overnight. And I said, oh no, you shouldn't do that because somebody will take it.
Where did he put it then?
He put it in the garage.
Did it
in my garage.
Isn't that something? Oh. And that you said they used to have big dinners when the deer hunters came?
Oh, yes. The church would have dinners. And I don't remember anything else.
Well, that hasn't changed. We still have the VFW. Hunters stew, and so some things stay the same, don't they? Oh, okay. Well, what else do you remember about Roscommon, what it was like when you first came here?
Was well, it wasn't very much.
No? Were the people friendly?
Yes. Yeah. People were nice.
Mm-hmm. And now I know you've been a member of the Congregational Church a long time. Was that church already here when you
came?
Oh,
yes. Yes. It's over 100 years old, the church. Mm-hmm.
So have you always gone to that church?
Yes.
Well, that's very nice. And you're still active in that church, I know. Did you own horses when you first came here, before your husband had the car business? Did you have a horse
no.
to get around, or you just...
No, we didn't have any horses.
No. So when did you have your own first car?
I don't know. We always had demonstrators.
You didn't have to have one, did you? Okay. Well, what things in Roscommon made the biggest changes, do you think?
Well, just about everything it changed.
Mm-hmm.
We have more churches, and we have the high school that was here. When I came here, was moved. up the side of the street, which now is the Valley Call.
Oh, okay.
That was a high school.
Oh.
And I remember when our school, our grade school over here, was a high school. And I remember when many energetic men worked for our new school, and we got it.
And it was a big town project to build the school, wasn't it? Yeah. So, where did your children go to elementary school?
Over here.
That was the elementary school too then? They went to all the way through?
All grades.
Oh, okay. And how many children do you have?
Three.
Three. And how many grandchildren?
I stopped there.
Oh.
Grandchildren, yes.
Seven grandchildren. That's nice. Okay. Let's see, what else do I want to ask about? What was your social life like when you were first married?
Well, I went to church. Of course, when the children started coming along, I had to more or less stay home. But they used to have, many of the old buildings had burned down. And I remember one, a grocery store, that had the second story, where they had basketball games.
Oh, okay. That was a price.
Where Ames's store is now.
Yeah, where Gavin's.
There was a grocery store.
Mm-hmm.
And the next to that, there was a hardware, which was run by Bill Canada.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
Of course, those buildings are all gone.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to me as though it's practically a new community.
Mm-hmm.
As buildings are concerned.
Mm-hmm. That's true. There aren't many old ones left. Well, tell us about this place where they had basketball on the second floor. That they had dances there too, didn't
they? Well, it was pretty rough because there wasn't much room for the bystanders, you know.
Oh.
And I remember I got hit.
Did your husband play basketball there?
Oh, this was before, I guess. This is before you came.
Oh, okay. Before he was in the picture. What happened that that building burned down?
Yes, it burned down.
Do you remember what the circumstances were?
It just
burned. I remember you telling once about the Lorac Lumber Company fire. Tell us how cold it was that night and all that.
Oh, it was way down below zero. It was awful. And the firemen had a hard time getting the hydrants opened.
And it just burned all night, you said. That should have been a spectacular fire.
That was in the 30s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How was Roscommon affected by the Depression?
We weren't affected too much.
You weren't?
No. We... That was when my husband was in business with John Dye. And the people would come and they hadn't had anything to eat. He would bring them over here and he'd feed them. Sometimes there were people that would come to the door and ask for food. Well, if it happened to be at mealtime, they came in and sat to the table with us.
Mm-hmm.
And had their meal. But as far as any hardship that we had, We didn't have a hardship.
Your business was okay through the depression?
Because that old saying, you get and it always comes back to you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's what happened to us.
Mm-hmm.
We were never stingy with helping people.
Well, see, that's why you're still here 100 years later.
Oh. I think it's about time that we had a cup of coffee.
Oh, that's okay with me. Okay, we've had our coffee and piece of carrot cake. So we'll get back to our interview.
You didn't say it was delicious.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Let's talk again about some of the buildings that were here when you came to Roscommon.
Well, the building that is located beside Dom's Cafe.
Mm-hmm.
That was here when I came. It was a drugstore.
Oh, okay.
So I can think of.
Well, then the cement one next to it, where you
yes.
said
and
where the Ace Hardware is now.
Ace Hardware now. That was here. It was just not quite too much.
It was probably fairly new then. And that's where you said that Mr. Price moved his grocery store after that building.
Mm-hmm.
And what about the Colonial Hotel?
Colonial Hotel was built over on 9th Street on the corner, I think 9th and Brookside.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a theater. I went to the very first picture they showed. The name of the picture was Bluebird.
Bluebird.
That was the name of the very first picture.
Did you like it?
Yes, it was a nice picture.
Good.
And that was there in business for a long time by Mr. Silsby. And his daughter, of course he died, and his daughter, Mrs. Lockway,
Mary,
became heir to it.
Mm-hmm.
And she moved it over on 5th Street.
That had to be a big project to move that building.
It was quite a project, but they did it. Yeah. And she had a real nice business for a long time. And finally she put in the liquor there.
So when she moved it, it was no longer a theater.
No.
She turned it into a hotel then.
Yeah, that's right. And then she and her son run it for many years, and then she died. Son's gone too. And they condemned it. I think it's condemned.
Yeah, well, it should be if it isn't. And you talked about, we talked about all the taverns in town.
Yes, but I wouldn't want to go on record though.
There were just too many of them.
Too many.
Too many. Okay. Let's talk about when the electricity first came and what changes that brought.
Well, it was a wonderful thing. It was a step toward progress.
I guess, a big step.
And the salesman came and went around every door, every resident. Most of them bought a refrigerator and a stove. And it was wonderful. It was just great. Well, we didn't buy one then, but we did later.
Mm-hmm. So your first electricity, you just changed all your lights?
No, we had to change the lights.
Oh, you didn't?
They just took right over. I think that was combined.
Oh. Okay, but when you said that you had a drop cord in each room,
yes.
When they first wired the house?
Yeah, that was from our old plant up here. And I guess after the consumers came in, we still had them. Oh, that's old hat now.
Yeah, but that was interesting. So the first electricity was generated here by the village?
Yes.
Before consumers came?
Yes.
And then tell us about how they turned it off.
At 12 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. At 12 o'clock.
Yes, it had to be turned off, so.
Okay, I think we're on again. We were talking about the electricity. They generated it here first, and then consumers' power came. Okay. When you were first married, did you have a garden here?
Not for a few years.
But then you did for quite a while?
We did. No, we didn't have a garden here. No, I think that, I don't remember that part, but I don't think that we had a garden right away.
But you used to do home canning?
Yes, well, we bought it.
You buy your, by the bushel?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember that there's been a lot of improvements in the area. By men that really they really worked hard for it, and the DeWitts erected their condominiums, which are occupied.
Yeah, they're nice.
It's a very attractive place.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the
River Forest.
River Forest Apartments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are nice.
And they're pretty well.
Mm-hmm. Now we have Hilltop Manor Nursing Home.
Yes, well, our nursing home was erected, and then the gentleman declared bankruptcy. And of course, then it was closed for about 5 years before they could find somebody that would take care of the financial affairs. And it's open now.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a nice apartment right there nearby. I don't know what the name of it is. And we also have a new village apartment over on Division Street, which are very nice.
Mm-hmm.
And the Malls Park, they built a pavilion down there. And it was named for Ted Wallace, who used to be a village in Hawaii. The Business Men's Association, they've done quite a lot of improvements to the village. They planted a row of shrubbery on Lake Street, which is very beautiful.
Yeah, that looks nice.
In the summer.
Mm-hmm.
Very beautiful. And we have sidewalk sales. Crafts.
Art in the Park?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Art in the Park. At Christmas time we have sidewalk sales.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Many more, which are too numerous to mention.
Okay, now I want you to make that statement about the tape belonging to the...
Did that go on?
Mm-hmm. Say that again.
In times, years past, we have had some very wonderful businessmen who have helped to make our town what it is. There was Bruce Rutledge, there was Harley Williams, Dr. Marzalka. Dr. Oppie. And many others who have helped make the town.
Mm-hmm. It takes
it improved the town.
People. Hardworking people.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have to work too hard to have taxes raised. Everybody seemed to be willing to cooperate with them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's like it is now. We have to convince people that the taxes should be raised in order to progress. Because that's all. And this tape is for the purpose of the use at Historical Society down at the Gallimore House.
Okay, Roscommon area. Okay. Thank you very much, Mrs. Shepherd.
Is that all right?
That's wonderful.